Hello. Today I am going to discuss Bucheraria Bancrofti, the systematic position of Bucheraria Bancrofti is as follows. It belongs to phylum Nematoda, class Cigrinentia, subclass Spiruria, order Spirurida, superfamily Phyleroidea and family Phyleridae, genus Bucheraria, and species is Bancrofti. The common name for Bucheraria bancrofti is Bancroft's filaria or Bancroft's filarial worm, producing Bancroft's filariasis or filariasis bancrofti. Some of the important synonyms for Bucheraria bancrofti are Filaria sanguinis hominis, which was given by Bush in 1872. Filaria bancrofti, it was given by Cobbold in 1877. Filaria nocturna was given by Manchin in 1891, and Bucheraria pacifica was given by Manson and Bahar in 1941. As far as the historical reports of this parasite are concerned, the earliest reports are as old as 600 BC, which were given by Shushrut, who was an ancient Hindu physician, and some reports have also been given by Persian physicians like Rhazes and Avicenna. They recognize the dramatic symptoms of filariasis and they refer to the disease as elephantiasis arabica. In the year 1863, Demarque demonstrated that microfilari are present in the hydrocelic fluid, and Bucherer in the year 1866 discovered the presence of microfilari in the chylus urine in some patients in Brazil. In 1872, Lewis found that these embryos in peripheral blood are present in some patients in India. During the year 1876 to 1877, Elder Bancroft recovered the adult females in Brisbane, while Sibthorpe in Bourne recovered adult male worms in 1888. Patrick Manchin in 1878 demonstrated that Culex pipiens quinquefasciatus or Culex fatigens was an intermediate host for Bucheraria, and in 1878 Patrick Manson described the nocturnal swarming of microfilari in the peripheral circulation and diurnal concentration in the lungs. Sir Philip Manson Bahar in 1912 and O'Connor in 1923 demonstrated that strict nocturnal periodicity does not occur in the natives of Polynesia. As far as the geographical distribution of this parasite is concerned, it is largely confined to the tropics and subtropics, and its range extends from 41 degree north latitude to 31 degree south latitude. It is found in South America, Cuba, Puerto Rico, West Indies, West and Central Africa, in Spain, Turkey, India, in southern China, Japan, Asia, Australia, and many South Pacific islands. In India, Bucheraria bancrofti is distributed mainly along the sea coast and also along the banks of big rivers like Ganga and Yamuna. However, it is not found along the banks of Indus River. This disease has been reported from Rajasthan, Punjab, Uttar Pradesh, and Delhi. As far as habitat of this parasite, Bucheraria bancrofti, is concerned, the adult worms are found in the lymphatic vessels and lymph nodes of man only. This is not a zoonotic disease. The adult worms are, as you can see here, that the adult worms are creamy white in color, and they are thread-like nematodes. They have very smooth cuticle. Their body tapers towards both the ends, both anteriorly and posteriorly, and the anterior and posterior ends are bluntly rounded. There are two small rings of small sessile papillae, which are present on the swollen head of the parasite, but the mouth is unarmed and the buccal vestibule is absent. The male worm is shorter than the female, and it measures around 2.5 cm to 4 cm in length and only 0.1 mm in thickness. The tail of the male worm is curved ventrally, and it possesses 12 pairs of perianal papillae. These papillae are pedunculated, of which eight pair of papillae are preanal, that means they lie before the anus, and 4 pairs of papillae are postanal, and these support narrow inconspicuous alley. 2 pairs of caudal papillae and 1 pair of larger sessile papillae are also present in the male, whereas caudal alley are lacking. The copulatory spicules are unequal in size and they are dissimilar in shape. The juberniculum is crescent shaped. Here is the juberniculum and this is the spicule of the male. The female worms are much larger than the males and they measure 8 to 10 centimeters in length and 0.2 to 0.3 millimeter in thickness. The tail end of the female is narrow and it is abruptly pointed. The position of the vulva is cervical. The short vagina together with outer segment of the uterus is single. Here is the vagina, but all the rest of the female genitalia are paired. The point to be noted here is that the females are ovoviviparous, that is, they lay eggs with well-developed embryos or live embryos. In the inner portion of the uterus, young embryos are enclosed within a hyaline ovoidal shell, and the embryo measures 38 by 25 micron in size. The shells of the embryos are much larger than the embryo itself, and they are elongated as the embryo passes from the inner portion of the uterus to the outer portion of the uterus, so that the shell is enlarged and elongated so as it can accommodate the uncoiling embryo. The shells are known, when the embryo enters the outer portion of the uterus, its shell is known as sheath, and the embryo is now known as the microphyllary. It is this stage where the mother worm discharges the embryos. Now the microphyllary. The microphyllaria or the microphyllary measures around 290 micron in length and 6 to 7 micron in width or breadth. The unstained embryos appear colorless and transparent with blunt heads and pointed tails. The microphyllary pass through the lymph nodes and they enter into the circulating blood through the main lymphatic trunks. These are highly active. When the dead microphyllary are stained with vital stains like Romanowski stain, the following morphological features are found. They have a hyaline sheath. This is larger than the embryo itself, and this sheath represents the chorionic envelope of the egg. The length of the sheath is around 359 micron. Then a cuticle is present. The subcuticular cells line the cuticle, and this cuticle is visible. Cuticle is visible only with the help of vital stains. Then the somatic cells or nuclei. These extend from the head up to the tail and they appear as granules. These are the somatic cells or nuclei which are arranged in the throughout the body of the microphyllaria. And but these somatic cells or granules are wanting at the anterior and the posterior extremity of the worm. In the anterior end, it is known as the cephalic space. The cephalic space is as long as it is broad. And in the cephalic space, an oral style is present, and then the tail region is also devoid of somatic cells or nuclei. The somatic cells or granules are broken at several spaces, and this is the landmark for the identification of the species. And these points where the somatic cells are broken is, the first is the an oblique space at the portion of nerve ring. Here the somatic cells are broken, and then the second is the anterior V spot. It represents the rudimentary, where the nephridiopore is there. It represents the rudimentary excretory system, and then the posterior V spot or the tail spot, it represents the terminal part of the alimentary canal or the rudimentary anus can be and a rudimentary anus can be seen at the position of the posterior V spot. A few G cells are present. In all there are 4 G cells. The second, third and fourth G cell or the germ cell which give rise to the gametes are situated near the anus or the posterior V spot, whereas the first V spot is much ahead. It represents the rudimentary and elementary canal. Then inner corpora or full bone or central body of Manson, it extends from the anterior V spot near the nephridiopore up to the G cell 1. Here it represents the rudimentary elementary canal. The lifespan of microfilary in human body is as long as 70 days. If the microfilary are not taken up by the intermediate host within this span of time, they die off. The periodicity of microfilary Bancrofti, a nocturnal periodicity is exhibited by microfilary in oriental countries like India and China, because the host of these species in oriental region are the culicine and the anopheline mosquitoes. They come for their blood meal during the night between 10 p.m. and 4 a.m. Therefore, these microfilary are present in the peripheral blood only between 10 p.m. and 4 p.m. Whereas in case of Pacific Islands, the intermediate host belong to Aedes species, and because they are present during the daytime also, they bite their host during the day also. So these microfilary Bancrofti do not exhibit any periodicity in Polynesian Pacific Islands. Now, the life cycle of Bucraria Bancrofti. The life cycle begins when the mosquito, which is infected with the infective stage, that is the L3 larva of Bucraria Bancrofti, it takes blood meal from the host, from the human host. The L3 larva enters the human blood and they lodge themselves in the lymphatics or the lymph nodes, where the larva grow into adult male and female. After mating, the female produces sheath microfilary, and these microfilary then migrate into the lymphatic and peripheral blood circulation. During the daytime, they retire in the organs like lungs, kidneys, liver, etc., while during the night they come into the peripheral circulation. Within 70 days, if a female mosquito takes a blood meal, it ingests the microfilaria along with the blood, and these microfilaria shed their sheath into the midgut of the mosquito, and then they migrate to the thoracic muscles. In the thoracic muscles, the microfilary are metamorphosed into the L1 larva, and this L1 larva is again transformed or metamorphosed into L3 larva, and this L3 larva migrates towards the anterior part of the mosquito and enters the proboscis. And from there, if this mosquito again takes a blood meal from the human host, it will reinfect, or it will infect some other human being. So, stages in the development of microfilaria in the mosquito. First of all, when the microfilaria is ingested by the mosquito, it is collected along the anterior end of the stomach. Within an hour or two, the microfilaria shed off their sheath and penetrate the gut wall and migrate to the thoracic muscles, and they begin to grow there. And after 2 days, the first stage larva is formed. It is a slender or thin snake-like microfilary. It is transformed into a thick, short, sausage-shaped form, which has a short, spiky tail and rudimentary digestive tract. It measures 124 to 250 micron in length and multiplied by 10 to 17 micron in width. Within 3 to 7 days, the first stage larva develops into the second stage larva, and it molds twice, or it molds or sheds its cuticles once or twice At the end of his stage, at the end of the second stage, it measures 225 to 330 micron in length and 15 to 30 micron in width. On the 10th or the 11th day, the second stage larva metamorphoses into the third stage larva. In the third stage larva, the tail atrophies to a mere stump and the body cavity, digestive system and genital organs become fully developed. This larva measures 1500 to 2000 micron in length and 18 to 23 micron in width. It has three subterminal caudal papillae. The third stage larva enters the proboscis sheath of the mosquito on or about the 14th day. And now this becomes infective to man. When the third stage larva are deposited on the skin near the site of puncture, when the infected mosquito bites the human being, after penetrating the skin, the third stage larva, they reach the lymphatic channels and settle down at some spot, and the spot for preference is according to the site of bite. If the mosquito bites on the lower extremities like legs near the lumbar region, the spot will be inguinal lymph nodes or the scrotal lymph nodes or abdominal lymphatics, and there the larvae, they begin to grow and they are finally transformed into the adult forms. This transition of L3 larva into the adult form takes about 5 to 18 months, and a new generation of microfilary is discharged, which after 5 to 18 months the male and female worms, they copulate, and then the female begins laying or discharging the microfilary. A new generation of microfilary is discharged, which passes either through the right lymphatic duct or the thoracic duct to the venous system, and then to the pulmonary capillaries, and then to the peripheral circulation, capillaries of the systemic circulation, and thus completing the cycle. The infected mosquitoes inoculate man during its blood meal. Highly endemic areas are characterized by presence of several human cases with microfilary circulating in their blood, and these human cases may be symptomatic or asymptomatic. And in the endemic areas, the exposure to Wuchereria microfilary begins very early in the childhood, and it continues throughout their life. The infection gradually builds up with each decade, and although it may not be clinically apparent, but repeated superinfection is seen to occur in the endemic area. Pathogenicity and clinical features. The pathogenic changes are confined to the lymphatic system, and the infection is known as Wuchereriasis or filariasis. The term filariasis is a common term. It denotes any pathological changes which are produced by the lymphatic lymph-dwelling Wuchereria and Brugia. The mode of infection is the inoculative method through the bite of mosquito, which may be Culex, Aedes or Anopheles. The transmitting agents are female mosquitoes of Culex or Aedes or Anopheles, like Culex pipiens petigens in India and China, Anopheles punctulatus in Melanesian islands except Fiji and New Caledonia, and Aedes polynesiensis in Polynesian islands. The infective form is the third stage larva, and the portal of entry is skin, and the site of localization is according to the site of bite, the lymphatic system of superior or inferior extremities. The most common site of localization is the inguinoscrotal region. The biological incubation period or the pre-patent period lasts for about 12 to 18 months. In this time, the stage 3 larva grows into adult forms and becomes sexually mature. Subsequently, after mating, the fertilized females begins to part urate, or it liberates the microfilary which appear in the peripheral blood, and this period of 12 to 18 months is known as the pre-patent period. The live microfilary circulating in blood, they do not produce any pathogenic effect except in occult filariasis. Occult filariasis is the filariasis in which the microfilary are not present in the peripheral blood or the lymphatic system, They are present in other organs like the lungs, the kidneys, and the liver, etc. Inflammatory reaction of lymphatic system of the human host is excited by the adult worms and developing larva, and this inflammatory reaction often leads to lymphangitis. Lymphangitis is the swelling of and infection of the lymphatic channels, and this forms the very basic lesions in the classical filariasis. However, in occult filariasis, where the microfilary is present in the organs other than the lymphatics, the lymphangitis, it is caused by microfilary, and it is found in lungs, liver, spleen, and also sometimes in lymph nodes. Some allergic reactions may be apparent or visible in the form of urticaria. Urticaria is the formation of hive-like structures due to swelling on the skin. Then there are swellings and lymphedema. The lymph accumulates in lymph nodes, and this lymphedema is induced by the metabolites of the growing larvae. The larvae release their metabolites in the lymph, and these metabolites cause allergic reactions in the individuals. The reactive individuals include the immigrant that have come to that endemic place in the recent past, or sometimes the unsuitable hosts also experience urticaria and fugitive swelling. There are several causes of lymphangitis, and first of these is the mechanical irritation. Mechanical irritation is caused by the adult parasites, and it is caused due to the movement of the parasites in the lymphatic system. Then liberation of metabolites. In highly reactive individuals, the metabolites which are secreted by the growing larvae, and some toxic fluids are also secreted by the fertilized female during parturition, also induce lymphangitis. Then absorption of toxic products. If any of the above toxic products are which are liberated from the dead worms undergoing disintegration are absorbed into the host, they also cause lymphangitis. Then bacterial infections can also be there. Although adequate evidences are lacking, but streptococci are known to develop as the secondary invaders, and they may supplement the Wuchereri in production of the characteristic lesions of Wuchereriasis. Causes of lymphatic obstruction. There are several factors which are responsible for lymphatic obstruction, that is the obstruction or blockage of the lymph channels. Are number one is the mechanical blocking. Mechanical blocking is caused due to the dead worms. The dead worms may calcify, or the worms may be present in bunches, in groups, and they act as an embolus which obstructs the flow of lymph. Then there can be obliterative endolymphangitis. This is due to the proliferation of the endothelial lining and the inflammation and thickening of the walls of the lymphatic vessels. Then there can be recurrent and repeated attacks of lymphangitis due to the excessive fibrosis of the lymphatic vessels, and fibrosis of afferent lymph nodes draining a particular area can also lead to lymphatic obstruction. The effects of lymphatic obstructions are, number one is the lymph varix or varicosity of the lymph vessels. Varicosity is the swelling up of any vessel, the swelling or dilating, and then elephantiasis. This is hypertrophy of the affected part. The affected part or the organ becomes very large, just like elephant. Now, the role of reticuloendothelial systems in Wuchereria infection is, the adult worms localize in the lymph nodes. Here you can see the male and females. These are localized in the lymph nodes. The circular TS is of male and the oval TS is of the female. And any factor that obstructs the lymph flow may result in the death of the worm. If these worms, they do not get appropriate amount of lymph for their nutrition, it will result in the death of these worms. And the worms give rise to cellular reactions of eosinophilic granulocytes in earlier stages around their location. In highly reactive individuals, the secretions of these worms excite local allergic regulations and lymphangitis and lymphadenitis. Lymphadenitis is infection of the lymph nodes, whereas lymphangitis is the inflammation or infection of the lymphatic channels. And due to the secretions, lymphangitis and lymphadenitis, because of hypertrophy of that particular area, this tends to strangulate the worm. ये इसका पैरासाइट का दम घुट जाता है और एलर्जिक मैनिफेस्टेशंस जो होस्ट के होते हैं उसकी वजह से इडिमा हो जाता है. और जो लिटोरल सेल्स हैं लिम्फ साइनसिस के, लिटोरल सेल्स आर द सेल्स विच आर फाउंड जस्ट इन द पेरिफेरी ऑफ द वर्म्स. दे बिगिन प्रोलिफरेशन, बहुत तेजी से उनमें डिवीजन होता है. और एंडोथीलियल सेल्स बहुत तेजी से डिवाइड होते हैं, जो कि एंडोथीलियल सेल्स जो कि विच मेक द लाइनिंग ऑफ द लिम्फेटिक चैनल्स, उनके प्रोलिफरेशन की वजह से धीरे धीरे जो ल्यूमेन है उसका ब्लड लिम्फेटिक वेसल का छोटा होता जाता है. और धीरे धीरे जैसे जैसे पैरासाइट की ग्रोथ होती है और उधर से एंडोथीलियल लाइनिंग थिक होती चली जाती है, तो इसकी वजह से थ्रोम्बोसिस या एम्बोलस बनना शुरू हो जाता है. पैथोजेनिक लेजन्स इन क्लासिकल फाइलेरियासिस कॉज्ड बाय बुकरेलिया बैनक्रॉफ्टी. फर्स्ट वन इज द लिम्फेंजाइटिस. लिम्फेंजाइटिस इन्वॉल्व द लिम्फ वेसल्स ऑफ द मेल जेनाइटल ट्रैक्ट. बेसिकली अधिकतर मेल जेनाइटल ट्रैक्ट की जो लिम्फ वेसल्स हैं वही अफेक्ट होती हैं. However, the favorite site for the adult of Bucherella bancrofti is the globus major of epididymis. Particularly, epididymis ka globus major part, wo uska favorite site hai. In the supergescent skin, the visible lymphatic trunks appear red congested streaks due to the presence of the adult worms in large numbers. And they also become painful and palpitations also occur and they appear as cord-like swellings. The attack of Bucherella lymphangitis tends to reoccur periodically once in every month. Then lymphadenitis. Lymphadenitis involves inflammation of the regional lymph nodes. Usually they are found in the groin and sometimes also in the axilla. And the tissue appears as soft and lobulated masses hote hain, choti choti usme gaanthe type nazar aati hain. And they are also associated with other bucherarial manifestations like swellings and obstruction of the lymph nodes. The swelling ke upar jo skin hoti hai wo adherent nahi hoti hai aur bahut zyada inflammation ya swelling wahan pe aa jati hai tab tak ye itni zyada painful bhi nahi hoti hai. The next manifestation is the filarial fever. Filarial fever is often high. It ranges from 103 to 104 degree Fahrenheit and it continues for up to 3 to 5 days. And the temperature comes down with profuse sweating just like as in malaria. And isme transient leukocytosis hota hai. White blood cells bahut zyada badh jate hain jisme ki neutrophils especially zyada badh jate hain. And this may also reveal, if you take out some blood, the blood may also reveal the presence of microfilary. Then hydrocele. Hydrocele is it results due to the obstruction of the para-aortic lymph nodes that cause interference in the drainage of lymph from tunica vaginalis, epididymis and spermatic cord. That means jo male sex organs hain wahan ke jo para-aortic lymph nodes hain, para-aortic lymph node means the lymph nodes which are present in the lumbar region. To unka obstruction jab ho jata hai to wahan pe fluids accumulate hona shuru ho jate hain. एंड ये तब होता है जब बुकरेलियल ऑर्काइटिस और एपिडिडाइमिटिस के बहुत सारे बार बार रेकरेंट इन्फेक्शन होता है, उस समय ये हाइड्रोसील डेवलप होता है. एंड ये हाइड्रोसील जो कंडीशन है दिस में एग्जिस्ट विद और विदाउट एलिफेंटियासिस ऑफ स्कॉटम. एलिफेंटियासिस कोई ज़रूरी नहीं है कि हर केस में हो. हाइड्रोसीलिक फ्लूड अगर यहाँ से एस्पायरेट लिया जाए तो यूजअली इट कंटेन्स माइक्रोफाइलेरी. और अडल्ट बुकरेरी चाहे वो लिविंग हो, डेड हो या कैल्सीफाइड हो, दे कैन बी डिमॉन्स्ट्रेटेड इन द बुकरेलियल ग्रैन्यूलेशन टिश्यू एंड वॉल ऑफ द सैक इज थिकेंड. The wall of the scrotum sac is thickened. Lymphatic vessels जो स्पर्मेटिक कॉर्ड में है वो भी बहुत थिक हो जाती हैं एंड दिस लीड्स टू लिम्फेटिक वेरिकोसेलिस और फनिकुलर लिम्फेंजियो वेराइसिस और अगेन इट इज द स्वेलिंग और डायलेशन ऑफ लिम्फेटिक वेसल्स. एलिफेंटियासिस इट माइट बी द एंड रिजल्ट ऑफ बुक्टीरियल इन्फेक्शन एंड इट यूजुअली अकर्स व्हेन द इन्फेक्शन हैज परसिस्टेड फॉर सेवरल ईयर्स एंड देयर आर केसेस ऑफ री इन्फेक्शन. And the part affected by hydrocele becomes enormously enlarged and it produces a tumor-like solidity. बहुत बड़ा हो जाता है और सख्त हो जाता है जो भी part hydrocele से सफ़र कर रहा है वहाँ पर. और हमेशा filarial infection ये ज़रूरी नहीं है कि elephantiasis उसमें होगा ही होगा. Elephantiasis जब होता है तो वहाँ पर fibrotic constrictions होती हैं afferent lymphatics जो कि एक particular part में drain कर रहे हैं और उस पार्ट में हाइपरट्रॉफी और हाइपरप्लाजिया होगा. हाइपरट्रॉफी इज एक्टिव डिवीजन ऑफ द सेल्स एंड द एनलार्जमेंट ऑफ दैट पर्टिकुलर पार्ट. और इसका ये इस वजह से होता है कि जो बहुत सारा जो लिम्फ के एग्जुडेट्स वहाँ पे इकट्ठा हो रहे हैं ड्यू टू द प्रेजेंस ऑफ प्रोटीन्स इन दोज एग्जुडेट्स दैट पर्टिकुलर पार्ट एनलार्जेस और उसकी वजह से जो कनेक्टिव टिश्यू है वहाँ पर उसकी एक्सेसिव ग्रोथ होती है क्योंकि प्रोटीन की प्रेजेंस में वो एक्सेसिव ग्रोथ स्टिमुलेट हो जाती है. ऑब्स्ट्रक्शन हो जाता है इनग्वाइनल या इलियक लिम्फ नोड्स का जिसकी वजह से एलिफेंटियासिस ऑफ लेग्स अकर्स. जबकि अगर स्क्रॉटम में एलिफेंटियासिस है तो वो होता है ड्यू टू द ऑब्स्ट्रक्शन ऑफ सुपरफिशियल इनग्वाइनल लिम्फ नोड्स. दीज आर सम photograph. This photograph shows the elephantiasis of leg and this is some lady with elephantiasis of the wrist area and the you can see the very enlarged thumb and the index finger. The first two index finger and the middle finger are enlarged. The ring finger and the small finger are of normal size and this one shows the elephantiasis of the scrotum. The pathological anatomy of elephantiasis. The skin of the area which is suffering from elephantiasis of the organ becomes very rough and fissure and warty. Hair also become very rough and sparse. The skin is thickened and it becomes dense and it also cuts like unripe pear. अगर उसका स्किन के सेक्शनिंग करी जाए तो एक कच्ची नाशपाती की तरह से वो कटता है. और सबक्यूटेनियस टिश्यूज जो हैं वो ब्लबरी या बहुत सॉफ्ट इडिमेटस अपीयरेंस जिसमें कोई जस्ट लाइक द वाटर बैलून वो इस तरीके की उसकी अपीयरेंस हो जाती है. और अंडरलाइंग मसल्स और बोन टिश्यू में हालांकि इसका कोई ऑल्टरेशन इसकी वजह से देखने में नहीं मिलता है. अगर हम हिस्टोलॉजिकल एग्जामिनेशन करते हैं उस पर्टिकुलर ऑर्गन का तो वहाँ पर बुक्टीरियल ग्रैनुलेशन टिश्यूज मिलेंगे. हाइपरप्लाजिया कनेक्टिव टिश्यू का मिलेगा और दीज सेल्स आर इन्फिल्ट्रेटेड बाय द ईओसिनोफिल्स ईओसिनोफिल्स देन प्लाज्मा सेल्स एंड मैनोसाइट्स एंड जायंट सेल्स अराउंड द डेड और कैल्सिफाइड बुक्टीरिया. द लिम्फेटिक वेसल्स ऑल्सो एग्जिबिट ऑब्लिटरेटिव एंडोलिम्फेंजाइटिस एंड थ्रोम्बस फॉर्मेशन. वहाँ पे थके जमने लिम्फ के शुरू हो जाते हैं. देन आमतौर पर अगर ब्लड की इस समय पर हम ब्लड का एग्जामिनेशन करते हैं तो माइक्रोस्कोपिक एग्जामिनेशन में इसमें आमतौर पर माइक्रोफाइलेरी यहाँ पर नहीं मिलते हैं या तो क्योंकि अडल्ट वर्म्स की डेथ हो चुकी है या अडल्ट वर्म्स अगर लाइव कंडीशन में भी हैं तो भी माइक्रोफाइलेरी क्योंकि ऑब्स्ट्रक्शन इतना हो गया है लिम्फ वेसल्स में माइक्रोफाइलेरी सिस्टमिक सर्कुलेशन में नहीं आ पाते हैं. नेक्स्ट फीचर इज द काइल्यूरिया. Caliuria is a specific condition in which the lymphatic fluids leak into the kidneys and due to which the urine turns milky white. And this urine contains fat particles and the fat particles they can dissolve in ether, chloroform or xylol. It also contains albumin. Albumin precipitates on boiling and fibrinogen If the fibrinogen is allowed to stand, it forms a coagulum. The microscopical examination of the sediments may also reveal the sediments of the chyle urea may reveal microfilaria or RBCs and lymphocytes. Next is the blood. Sometimes microfilary may be detected in examination of peripheral blood. The geographical variations of filarial lesions. Chyle urea occurs mainly in China, Japan and South India, but chyle urea is rare in Africa and Pacific Islands. Whereas hydrocele is prevalent in East Africa, Japan and China, but it is less common in India and Pacific Islands. Then elephantiasis of leg and scrotum is predominant in China, India and Pacific Islands, but elephantiasis is rare in West Africa. The clinical manifestations of filariasis include, they may be asymptomatic filariasis, that means if the infection is of very low frequency, then the patient may be asymptomatic, they may not show any symptoms. But if there are repeated infections or super infections, then the patient may show some symptoms of filariasis, and in the symptomatic filariasis, the first phase is the inflammatory phase. Inflammatory phase is characterized by lymphangitis and lymphadenitis, and it lasts only for a few days. Whereas the obstructive phase is characterized by varicose lymph nodes of groin and axilla, of lymph scrotum, hydrocele, chyle urea, and elephantiasis in various body parts. For diagnosis, the methods adopted for diagnosis can be divided into direct evidence and indirect evidence. Direct evidence includes detection of microfilary either in the peripheral blood during if the blood sample is taken at night or from the lymph samples. The lymph may be taken from the lymph nodes or detection of the adult worms. Adult worms can be seen if biopsy of lymph nodes is done, or if X-ray of enlarged organ is done, it may also reveal some calcified worms. Then there are some indirect evidences. Indirect evidences include serological methods and antibody detection. The serological methods include the for doing the immunoglobulin titer, the IgG4 level is increased considerably, and the patients with tropical pulmonary eosinophilia, in addition to elevated eosinophilia, they may also show a marked IgE response. Whereas in antigen detection, it can be used for by PCR assay, in ICT card test for serum specimen, then TROP bio ELISA for serum specimens, and TROP bio ELISA for filter paper specimens can be used. Then another method is xenodiagnosis. Xenodiagnosis is demonstration of microfilary in the blood in the stomach of specific mosquito vector. This mosquito vector was allowed to bite the suspected infected individual. Agar kisi ke upar shak hai lekin aap recover nahi kar pa rahe wahan se worms ya larvae, अडल्ट नहीं रिकवर कर पा रहे हैं, तो जो मॉस्किटो वेक्टर स्पीशीज हैं, दे आर मेड टू बाइट दैट पर्टिकुलर पेशेंट, और फिर उसमें देखा जाता है कि आगे उसमें माइक्रोफाइलेरिया डेवलप हो रहे हैं या नहीं. लेकिन ये बहुत यूजफुल नहीं है, क्योंकि इसमें एक मॉस्किटो लगभग 1 से 3 mm ब्लड पुल लेता है, तो दैट ब्लड इज नॉट सफिशियंट टू डिटेक्ट. देन ट्रीटमेंट इंक्लूड्स डाइथाइल कार्बा mazine citrate or DEC and ivermectin, which is known also under the name Bactizan. In patients with elephantiasis, surgical procedures are required. As far as the prophylaxis is concerned, unlike malaria, a short stay in the endemic area is usually of no significance. Mass chemotherapy with DEC is effective method of controlling the infection in a given population. The references are parasitology, protozoology and helminthology by K.D. Chatterjee, and parasitology or medical zoology by Rastogi Publications. These are the books that have been